The Lord has blessed us with another nice morning for services. It's a real run of Sunday mornings we've had. Emergency restroom entrance is over there where those gentlemen are standing with their yellow vest. And we have some ice water over here by the entrance to the pavilion. And I want you to mark on your calendars the end of July, July 26th and 29th, we plan to have a tent revival of sorts right here. You see we have the tent already set up for the rest of the month, which is nice. And the Taylors are coming to sing and to preach. Starting on Sunday night, I'll give a message. And then Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday night, they will be preaching. And Wednesday night will be a concert at 7 o'clock in the evening. So I invite you to that. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father God, I believe with all my heart that we come here today in a different July 4th mood. Father, this July 4th, rather than just celebrating and being thankful, I have been deeply concerned and anxious about many things in this, my country. Lord, our nation is looking for its soul. It's looking for leadership of what she will be in the future. Lord, there is disunity, and there is confusion. There is anxiety and anger and uncertainty from many different directions. And I pray that you would step into that void and that we would let you. Lord, we may not be able to change anything in Washington this instant, Lord, but we can invite you to change us. So I pray that you just meet us this morning, and that as we give thanks for this nation that you have allowed us to spend a little time in before we go to our true homes in heaven, I pray that you would give us wisdom and that we would be able to show a light of a different way, a different spirit, a different leader than many know, Jesus Christ. In the name of the Lord, we pray in worship. Amen.
Thank you.
occasion. Well, I have showed some of you this before, and this is primarily for our young folks. This stick is a little bit short for me to go walking with because my grandfather made this for me when I was a boy, and he would always take me walking with him on the farm or out in the woods and wherever we were, North Carolina, or if he visited me at my house, we'd go walking and exploring the woods. I usually didn't know where I was going and didn't know the way, and was a little defenseless. I remember one time I almost stepped on a snake, and he pushed me aside and took his walking stick and took care of that snake. Lickety-split. But it was okay, because wherever I was walking with him, he was there, walking right beside me. And I just followed his lead. And I never remember even once feeling anxious that I was going to get lost or that something was going to happen to me. That's a little bit like the image that the Bible uses in 23rd Psalm when it says, "The Lord is my shepherd." He walks beside us. And even though we're in unfamiliar territory, even though we don't know where we are sometimes, or we may encounter things more dangerous than snakes even, he's there with us. If we can trust him, and if we could follow him rather than just trying to find our own way. Father God, I just pray for the young parents who are listening online. Many of the children are staying at home because of the virus. And Lord, I pray that you would bless those families. And Lord, just as those kids find it so easy to follow the lead of their parents and those that they trust, I pray that the rest of us would be able to trust you and to follow you and to count on you. And Lord, we trust that you are there. We need you in times like this. Christ, we pray. Amen. The Bible often uses the image of sheep talking about me and talking about all of us. Now, how many of you, or do we have anyone here, raise your hands if you have ever worked with sheep, literal sheep. All right. Literal sheep? All right. He has. I have seen sheep, and I've seen shepherds, and one thing that really stands out to me when I think of sheep, and I'm sure Donald could attest to this, did you have them on the farm when you were growing up? Okay. Totally defenseless. Really clueless. That's the way sheep are. They need someone to protect them from predators. They need someone to feed them. They're anxious animals. They're always a little edgy and skittish, and rightly so, because they don't have any defense other than just running, and they can't even run that fast. And so they need shepherds to take care of them, whether they fence in the land or whether, like in Bible times, they walk with the sheep wherever they go, and put them in folds. And this has been going on for thousands of years. In 1999, when I went to Jordan on an archaeological dig, we would do desert surveys and be walking out in the desert looking for artifacts or old cities or places of occupation. And I would often find these circles of stone in the middle of the desert. And I would think I found something. And I'd ask an archaeologist, well, this is definitely human occupation. Could this be a village or some, you know, he goes, no, sheepfold. And I go a little farther and, you know, I find another circle of stones and that looked pretty substantial. I said, well, what about this? He goes, sheepfold. He said, that could have been there, that could have been built 100 years ago or 2,000 years ago. I don't know. But it's still here. And the nomads, as they have, for thousands of years, as they lead their sheep through the wilderness, through the desert, they would build these little containment walls, circles of stone with an entrance. They usually had an entrance. And at night, because there were predators about, wolves, hyenas, bears, there were even lions 1,000 years ago, they would herd all the sheep inside of this fenced-in area with surrounded by rock, and the sheep and the shepherd would actually just spend the night laying across the opening. And so the shepherd would basically keep the sheep in and safe, and anything coming to get the sheep would have to go through him to get in to take care of, you know, to take a sheep. And in fact, oftentimes shepherds would share a fold, where different flocks would come into the same fold, and all of the sheep would bed down together in the night, close packed in. And in the morning, when they went out to find pasture, each shepherd would call out his sheep, and the sheep knew his voice because they walked with him all day long, every day, and had trusted in him. And each shepherd would take his sheep out, and they would go out and find pasture. Now, in John chapter 10, that is the image that Jesus draws on for him as the good shepherd and me as a sheep. Now, looking around, as I mentioned in the opening prayer, our country right now, and us, even as members of this church or folks in this community, feel a little like sheep. Amen? When I talk to you, and I've talked to many of you, I hear that edgy skittishness in your voice as you think about what you've seen on the news. And it's confusing sometimes. You could see the merit or the goodness in one argument, and then that side will just go crazy with it. Or they'll see goodness or the merit in this side over here, and then they just go to an extreme with it. And we don't know which way to go as a country. And we as Christians and Americans don't really know what's going to happen. Amen? And it's an uncertain time that we live in. And we're like sheep that are nervous and anxious and looking around. Is that a wolf behind that rock? Did I just hear something? Am I going to be fed? Am I going to have a place to sleep? Is my home going to be the same for my children's generation as it was for me? Obviously not. Is it going to be better, worse? And we're just on edge. So this morning I want to look at John chapter 10. And I want you to realize that your shepherd does not live in a parsonage. Your shepherd doesn't live in the White House. Your shepherd doesn't live in Congress. Your shepherd is not an influencer online. Your shepherd is not the coach of a sports team. You have a good shepherd that is not here to fleece you. His shepherd, his name is what? Jesus. So let's look at John chapter 10. John chapter 10. Starting in verse 7. And I want to start off with this. I want you and I to enter the door to a whole new life. To enter the door to a whole new life. One big misunderstanding that people have about following Jesus is that he's going to improve your life. He's going to help you live your life a little better. He's going to make you a better person. Or he's going to get you through this. That's not what Jesus is all about. He is introducing an entirely new life altogether. An entirely different way of thinking about things. I hope you heard that in his sermon that I stole last week, the Sermon on the Mount. I mean, what he is offering is an whole new destiny, a whole new way of thinking, a different way of being right. And it's all based on him. Listen to what he says, starting in verse 7 of chapter 10. So Jesus said to them, "Truly, truly," in Greek, "Amen, amen, I say to you, I am the door of the sheep." So remember that image that I painted for you of the fold. The sheepfold. There's Jesus laying across the door, deciding who comes in, who comes out. He says, "Truly, truly, I say to you, I am the door of the sheep. Now all who came before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not listen to them. I am the door. If the elite come to me," is that what it says? It says, "If anyone enters by me, he or she will be saved and will go in and out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and to kill and to destroy. But I have come that you may have life and have it more abundantly. I am the good shepherd, the shepherd who lays down his life for the sheep." Enter the door to a whole new life. Now, unlike sheep, who basically have very little will or ability to choose whatsoever, they're just sheep, you have a will. You have a decision. Now, my will is weak. Often I can't do the things I even want to do. I am a divided person inside. There's a part of me that wants to follow Jesus, and there's a part of me that doesn't want to. Still, entering into this new life of Jesus being your shepherd is a decision. First of all, it's Jesus' decision. In Revelation chapter 3, verse 20, Jesus says, "Hey, look, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone," there's that anyone again, "if anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with him, and he will eat with me." It will begin a new life together. Jesus has already made his choice for you. He wants you. You may say, well, in John chapter 10, he's talking to Jews. Well, no. Then later on in verse 16, he says, "I have other sheep that are not of this fold, and I need to bring them in also." That's talking about us. Jesus already has decided that he wants to save you, and he has done it. He stands at the door. He is the door, the only way to enter into this new life. Or you can live your life by your own wits and by the questionable judgment calls of politicians and preachers and influencers. Or you can choose him. Now, the other choice is ours. Jesus said in Luke chapter 13, verse 24, "Strive to enter into the narrow door. I tell you, many will seek to enter, but will not be able." In other words, there's a time coming when this opportunity ends. Now, why is entering into the life of Jesus so difficult? Why does Jesus call it narrow? Because I like to be in charge. I want to be right. Have you ever watched a two-year-old? If you've ever raised a two-year-old, you've seen this many times, where you have something that's good for them. Maybe they have no idea how to do a task, or you have something you want to give them, and you just see them tense up and bristle up. And no, they're going to do it all by themselves, even though they have no idea what they're doing. That's me, basically, with God. I want to be right. I want to be a good person. I want to figure things out. And basically, I'm a sheep that scatters off from the flock and is a sitting duck for whatever the world or for whatever thief like Satan comes to take me away. Enter the door to a whole new life. Now, when we follow Jesus, when you trust in him, and most of you here have done that, this is a new life of going out and coming in. If any of you have spent time by the water, you know about the tides, right? Every day, the water goes out and comes in. It goes with the cycles of the moon. It is predictable. And yet it's as necessary as breathing for the water. It goes out and comes in. I tell you what, if you want to know, if you just want to go out, then just exhale. Don't inhale. And let me know how that works out for you. Or if you just want to stay in, you just inhale and hold it and don't exhale. It's like that a little bit with our lives with Jesus. There are fold times where he takes us in and lays us down and bids us be still and wait. And then there are go times where he leads us out into unfamiliar territory to find pasture. And we go through seasons of life that are fold times or go times. And I know me, I go a little crazy in both. For instance, I'll go through fold times where Jesus basically leads me in and sets me down, and I'm like just waiting for life to go on. Okay, how long is this going to last, Jesus? Okay, this virus thing, I'm kind of done. Was done months ago, Jesus. When is life going to get back to normal? I mean, really, Jesus? Or maybe you have an illness that's keeping you under bay. For instance, I have a kidney stone right now trying to make its way through my system. And I'm like, okay, all right, it was fun. It was great, okay? But it's time to move on to the next phase. And Jesus is like, no, you just wait. You just wait. I'm going to be with you here. All right, have you ever felt that way? Just waiting for life to go on to the next stage, and you don't feel like anything really will start until you get through this fold time in your life, like sheep bedded down tight and they don't have anywhere to go. Know that the good shepherd is giving you rest in the fold time. He is teaching you patience. He's showing you things about himself. I believe that most growth in a Christian's heart happens during fold times where we just are forced to hunker down and wait. Amen? Amen. You know, Abraham's life, we just worked through that in the devotions. Abraham's life, you know, he was in the fold times. Most of the chapters in Genesis that we read, he was just waiting for God to do something. But it was in that waiting that Abraham was transformed as a person. And he was freed from the selfish thinking that was so natural to him. He was freed from the impatience that we all had. His faith grew by leaps and bounds until he could trust God even when he couldn't feel God, even when he couldn't see God. And in the same way, follow Jesus in the fold time. Are you there now? Nothing's wrong with you if you're there in the fold. God hasn't left you. Jesus is blessing you and calling you to follow him there in the fold. But then there are go times. And interestingly enough, I could wait and wait and wait for Jesus to do something and complain and get impatient and wonder if he's gone somewhere. And then when he leads me into unfamiliar territory, I want to go back to the fold. Amen? He's like, okay, it's go time. Let's go. And he gets up out of the door and he's like, I'm calling you out. It's time to go somewhere else. It's time to try something else. It's time to go talk to this person. It's time to make this decision. You're like, I don't know, Jesus. Things were a lot more familiar back there in the fold. I kind of like that safety. I kind of like that you were taking care of me. I'm kind of like that I was comfortable. I could sleep. I could talk to my friends back there. Why are you leading me off on that distant horizon over there? And yet, Jesus calls us to follow him in go times. Now, what we're going through right now, it's a little bit like a fold time in some ways, but as Christians, as God's church, this is a go time. All right, we've been comfortable for a long time. We've been sitting on our hands a long time, amen? Now, when things get tight and when things get uncertain and the world is looking for answers and direction, That's the time. That's go time for Christians to stand up and follow Jesus and actually show the world a different way than they see on the news or on the streets every day. To actually see Jesus as we follow him. And they'll be like, what? What's going on there? Why do they not cuss me out when I cuss them out? Why is it that they're being generous with me when I haven't done anything for them? How come they're not losing their temper? How come they're keeping their spirits up when they have cancer? How is it that they come to me and they pray for me when it doesn't seem like God's done anything for them? It doesn't make sense, and it gets their attention, and they start to look beyond you for the reason for what's going on in your life. And Jesus uses that to bring them to the door of a new life. The question is, are we going to block the door? Yeah, I've been to public events, you know, and a fire marshal has come up and said, excuse me, you need to move. You're blocking the door. You know, you've got to keep the doorways, the exits open, or the entrances open. Are you blocking the door? Is the church blocking the door to Jesus in our effort to get to him? I think of Jesus. Remember that man that was paralyzed? And he was trying to get to Jesus, and his friends tried to carry him to Jesus, and they couldn't get through to him because all the people who could walk were blocking the door. So they came through the roof. Let's think about the church. And before we do that, I want to share this. I visited my brother and his family when he lived in Lake of the Woods up towards Fredericksburg. Don't know if you know where that is, but it's a gated community there. And they were having a family reunion. This is years ago. I still had all my sons with me and my wife, and we piled into a minivan. Looked very innocent. Now, I don't think there was anything threatening or gangster-like in our appearance. We were there with food that we were bringing and birthday gifts or whatever. And we come into the gate, I think it was just after nightfall. And boy, they put some SWAT team, Navy SEAL guard there at the guard shack, at the entrance to that gated community. And he stood out and stopped and shined the flashlight on the car, wanted us to turn on the lights and open the doors. And he's like, do you have an appointment? And we're like, yes. We know when we mentioned the person's name of the family we're going, he said, we don't have any record of them calling and saying that you could come in. And I mean, this thing went on and on for like 10 minutes. We're sitting there. I thought I was going to jail after a while. And finally, they got in touch with one of the family members, and they're like, oh, they're okay. He was like, all right, just stop going in. You know, who came in? It's like he was the doorkeeper, and we could not get in past the gate. Yeah, that's fine. He was doing his job. I guess he was keeping his community safe. But let me ask you, is that the church? Is this a gated community where we kind of hold people back at a distance for the sake of getting our way and staying comfortable and basically deciding who is worthy to come to the door of Jesus? Or do we let Jesus be the gatekeeper and we just show people the way? Amen? It's very easy. So easy. In fact, natural for me as a pastor and for you as ministers in this church, fellow ministers in this church, to step in the place of gatekeeper. Jesus said, I am the door. And in verse 11, he says, I lay down my life for the sheep so that they could come in and come out. Who am I to say, it's up to me to decide now? Jesus, you didn't really mean anyone. It's up to me to be the gatekeeper. Let's us as a church hold on to the identity, to the purpose that you already have, and you know it well. You have a heart for people. People need the Lord, as she just sang, and you know that. I know that you care about people. Hold on to that and remember that we are accountable if we stand in the way of the Lord because of our own little nonsense. Amen? Our job as a church is not to be comfortable, but to bring people to Jesus. Don't forget that. I don't want to forget that. Father God, people need the Lord today. And we think about ourselves and we think about our prayer request needs, and that's good. We need to. But Lord, for every time I think about myself or I think about the needs of this church, may I be thinking about those who need Jesus for the first time in their lives, Lord. Be the good shepherd and bring in others, another flock. In also, maybe that didn't grow up in this church, maybe that look a little different, maybe that were raised a little different. Lord, help us not to block the door. And Lord, wherever we are, whether it's a fold time or a go time, we want to go in and out with you, following you. Give us hope, give us patience and trust, like I had for my grandfather when I walked with him. May we walk with you. And all God's people said, amen. Well, we're not supposed to congregationally sing, and that's what I want to do. All right. Cover your mouths. And let's sing Amazing Grace together.
Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me.
Good Shepherd. Lord, I pray that next time we watch the news and we're confused or we're anxious or we're angry, I pray that we would stop and look to you for direction. Lead us in and lead us out. as we go from this place into your mission field. Christ, we pray. Amen.
Amen.